when you're 68 years old and they say, we'd like you to give this talk, which I did a similar talk once before for Tom's class, and they say, we want to videotape it, and you're 68 years old, you know what that means. We want to get this on tape before this guy is dead or demented. Because I have what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about, the topic is the history of marriage and family therapy in Georgia, as I understand it. And I've been involved in it kind of all along the way. So I'm going to be telling it from there may be pieces I'll miss, but because I'm telling it from my personal experience. So the story I'm telling you is really the history of marriage and family therapy in Georgia as I was involved in it as I experienced it. What I'm going to do is I'm going to talk first about the history of the practice of marriage and family therapy in Georgia, and then I'm going to talk about the history of the profession, the organization of the profession, and the regulation of the profession in Georgia. So I'll divide it into those two parts. Okay? In terms of just further introducing myself, so you know, why am I qualified to give this? Why me? Why would I be talking about this? Why would I be the guy that he would pick to talk about this? By the way, some of what I'll say occurred before 1970, and that's just secondhand, because I moved here in the end of 1969. I came to Georgia to be in a doctoral program in psychology, what happened was that in 1972, I did my practicum, and then the next year I was hired, actually left the doctoral program, never finished my doctoral degree, was hired at a place called the Bridge Family Center, which was the first place in Georgia to be working with whole families, and worked there till 1980. In 1980, I went into private practice with, have they heard of Gus Napier? They don't know who Gus Napier is, okay. But he was one of the nationally known family therapists in Atlanta. I'll talk about that later. And practiced with him until he retired whenever he retired, 1997. But at the same time that I went and left the Bridge, where I was employed, and went into private practice, where, as Sylvia said, one of the people I went to practice with, a euphemism for unemployed, because at the beginning I had no clients. I had a lot of free time. I got involved in the process of negotiating, writing, and then getting to the legislature, the licensing law for marriage and family therapists, professional counselors, and social workers. And that took from 1980 to 85, big project. And then in 85, I was appointed to the state licensing board, and I sat on the state licensing board for the first 8 years of its existence. And in that time, I discovered that there was no national licensing exam in marriage and family therapy. And it was like, we had a license. We were the seventh state to license marriage and family therapists in the country. And a company called PES was just basically scamming everybody. They had this mimeographed thing. Talk about a secure exam. This mimeograph, they just photostated it. They gave it out and used the same test everywhere, every time. 200 questions. Three of them had to do with marriage and family therapy. The other 197 had to do with counseling. And so I said, well, this is ridiculous. We can't do this. So I then founded the Association of Marital and Family Therapy Regulatory Boards, which is the organization of all the boards in the country that license marriage and family therapists. By that time, there were 10 of them. And then we then went through the process of developing, and AMFTRB still owns and operates the national licensing. We went through the process of developing the exam. If any of you become licensed, are any of you intending to become licensed as marriage and family therapists? Maybe? None of the rest of you? You're all going for what, LPC or ultimately?
LCSW.
Okay. Well, so much for that. but there will be, but that, at least I was participating in getting that whole board in existence. And then when I left the board in 94, I was then the legislative chair for the Georgia Association for Marriage and Family Therapy. And then from 97 to 2009, I was the executive director of the Georgia Association for Marriage and Family Therapy. And then from 2009 to now, I'm again the legislative chair. And what I'm saying to the Georgia Association for Marriage and Family Therapy is we have to get somebody else to learn to do this because I'm going to die someday. And you can't just keep on relying on me to do the legislative work for this profession. So I was down in the Capitol last, as recently as Friday, you know, and I'll be there tomorrow because we're in town. Now the legislature's in session working on legislation into our professions. So basically, that's my involvement with the profession. So that's my particular resume, so to speak. Now, let me switch to the history of the practice of marriage and family therapy in Georgia, okay? First, I'm going to go backwards before I got here, because to really understand the history of marriage and family therapists in Georgia, in some ways, you need to know about the 1970 when I got here. Let's go back to World War II. There was a place called Oak Ridge in Tennessee. You know about what happened in Oak Ridge? Anybody? Not a soul. You know what? I just really feel dated. So that's where they were working in two places, Oak Ridge and in Los Alamos, with developing the first atom bomb. Okay? And they had all the top minds in physics in the country into those two places. And they were not allowed to communicate with anybody. Totally. Top secret, absolutely. You couldn't get more top secret, okay, than that. And so what they did is they also brought in a bunch of psychiatrists to work with all these top flight physicists who were cut off from saying, okay. And among those was Carl Whitaker and John Workington and Tom Malone. I don't know if Felder was with them or not at the time. You think he was? Dick Felder was with them at that time. And they were there at Oak Ridge until the end of the war, helping to keep these. In 1945, they leave lock, stock, and barrel from Oak Ridge, Tennessee, and come to Atlanta. And they basically, I do not know if there was a psychiatry department at Emory University before then. If there was, they replaced it. If there wasn't, they started it. Whatever. They became the psychiatry department at Emory University. From 1945 until 1955. Back then, this question about how much you know about the history of therapy. What was psychotherapy back then? Does anybody know? Okay. Psychotherapy back then was Freudian analysis. Okay. All psychotherapy was Freudian. You either lay on the couch or you didn't. If you laid on the couch, the therapist sat behind you so you couldn't see them, and you free associated. Okay, you just spoke whatever came to your mind. Okay, and even if the therapist talked, faced you, not talked to you, faced you, even the therapist faced you, you didn't talk with them and they didn't talk with you. The idea was, and I'm not going to go into explaining all this, what was behind it, but the therapist to be a blank slate because you were projecting onto the therapist transference who you made them into who you wanted to make them. They needed to be a blank slate so they could become a transferable object. Analyze the transference. I mean, that was part of the process. So it was important for the therapist to be really blank. Well, so that was the prevailing way of doing psychotherapy when Whitaker and Malone and Workington and Felder came to Emory University. And over the course of that 10 years, they developed a whole new way of doing psychotherapy. They called it experiential. And what they did is they actually talked to their clients. They actually developed a relationship with their client. This was radical. This was really radical, okay? And the essence of experiential therapy really was, they called it experiential because it was the experience in the room that was the basis for the therapy, okay? For instance, the presumption is that if I relate a certain way in my world, I will relate that same way to the therapist. And what happens in the relationship between me and the therapist becomes the meat for the therapist. And you talk about and focus on that and pay attention to that. This is a whole new, by the way, that approach really has affected all psychotherapy since then. I mean, it's no longer thought of in terms of individual therapy. It's influenced all psychotherapy. In 1955, I wrote a book, Whitaker Malone, called Roots of Psychotherapy, which laid this out. Do you know if it's in print at all? When I was in graduate school, we had to get it out of the library, and we took it and we photostated the whole book, all however many pages of it, to read it, you know, because it wasn't in print. But that book was their manifesto, their model of therapy. But about that time, there became, and I'm not sure exactly what happened. I think maybe some graduate students complained because what they were doing is they were teaching all the, what their job was, the psychiatry residency program, okay? And they had all the psychiatry residents in these groups where they did this in the groups. What went on in the room became the source of the therapy, and they kind of did experiential therapy with all the residents. I think maybe some residents complained. I'm not sure exactly what happened. But there got to be a scandal. I'm told it actually made the front page of the Journal Constitution at one point. And essentially lock, stock, and barrel. I'm not sure they were fired. I'm not sure they quit. I'm not sure what happened, but they all left all at once. And they formed the Atlanta Psychiatric Clinic, APC, and began practicing this new kind of therapy. And so that went on for the next 10 years. Whitaker used to say his life was in 10-year segments. 45 to 55, 55 to 65, 65. When I first met him, it was 1975. And in 65, that group broke up, okay? Part of them stayed in their office at Buckhead in Atlanta, if you know Atlanta. Part of them moved to an office in Sandy Springs. And Whitaker moved to Wisconsin. And what he said was that he had decided at that point that you really couldn't get meaningful change unless you involved three generations in the therapy. So this is the germ of his beginning to think about family therapy, okay? He said that, and he moved to Wisconsin and began developing then experiential family therapy up at University of Wisconsin. So that's in 1965. Now, in terms of then my experience, about 5 years later, so all that happened before I was here, in 1969, 1970, I arrived in Atlanta into the psychology program at Georgia State University. I came there because it was fairly obscure school, but in psychology circles, it was known for innovative approaches to psychotherapy. Most psychotherapy programs around the country, first of all, and then you get your degree in psychology, you were trained as a researcher first, you still made it that way, as far as I know, and as a therapist, kind of second. And the therapy approaches in most programs in the country were either analytic, which we've discussed, or behavioral, or Rogerian. You know what Rogerian is, probably. You know, Carl Rogers, client-centered therapy. Well, none of those particularly intrigued me, but at Georgia State, they were doing innovative things. A woman named Joan, the two women who were kind of founded that program, Joan Fagan and Irma Shepherd, the approach they were most associated with was Gestalt therapy. And it is absolutely that is very interesting, in fact, I think fascinating, how that came off of Freudian thinking, but that's not the subject of this presentation, so I won't talk about that. Except to say that I was kind of proud of myself. Back then, I thought of myself as a fourth generation therapist. Fritz Perls was the theorist who developed Gestalt therapy. Fritz Perls was trained by Sigmund Freud, so I thought Sigmund Freud trained Fritz Perls. Fritz Perls trained Fagan and Shepherd, and Fagan and Shepherd trained me. So I was a fourth generation. Freud was my great-grandfather as a therapist, you know. I thought that was kind of interesting back when I was 25 years old. I came there, but that ended up not having as much of an influence on me. What happened was the supervisor, because we did a lot of, Georgia State, compared to many other programs, was very much focused on training psychotherapists, as opposed to training people to be researchers first and therapists second. And so it was very clinically oriented. And the therapist who had the most influence on me was, now I'm going back, Dick Felder. Remember that name, Dick Felder? One of the people who've been at Oak Ridge with Whitaker Moat, one of the people at APC. And he part-time came down and supervised people in the program. So Felder was the supervisor who influenced me the most. And so I began becoming an experiential therapist, essentially, because of his influence on me. The second thing that happened was I read a book in my very first course there. Joan Fagan did an interesting thing. She had us read these various books about theories of therapy, and we were each assigned a patient who was in the private practice. They had a group called Pine River, separate, a practice separate from the department. And they would take
clients from that practice, and we were each assigned one, and we were assigned to go to their home and sit. It's very kind of weird when I think about it now, but we would sit. We were assigned to just sit in the corner and watch them. And we had to do it for four different occasions, at least 4 hours at a time. Okay? And we were reading all these books, and then we had to write this report up saying what we saw going on in the family. And I read this book, one of the things assigned, Pragmatics of Human Communication by Vaclav Bateson Jackson. At least Vaclav Bateson Jackson. These people probably have never, I don't think anybody.
No, we heard Jackson because that's Palo Alto.
Okay, and you've heard of Jackson. Well, these Vaclav Bateson Jackson were all at Palo Alto.
Yeah.
They were all there. Okay, this is the Palo Alto group. And these were the first people, they were the folks who in the 60s were beginning to say, hey, you know, psychoanalysis works with neurosis, but what about psychosis? What about character disorder? It doesn't seem to have any benefit. And so they started looking at other things, and they started looking at the family and family interactions. Okay, and that was the beginning, really, the first folks to talk about working with families, really, in regard to severe mental illness, was the idea. And they wrote this book called Pragmatics of Human Communication, which was, to me, incredibly fascinating. I'll just mention two things from it. Number one, the notion that you can't not communicate. They had these rules in the beginning. One was you can't not communicate. To not communicate is a communication. If I don't communicate with you, if I don't talk, I just stand here, that is a communication. That's saying something. Okay, radical idea at the time. They also said that all communication was occurring always on two levels. There was the content level, and where information is being exchanged, and there's the relationship negotiation level. That the relationship is always being negotiated. So every communication is occurring on two levels. For instance, the communication here, content level, I'm telling you about the history of family therapy in Georgia. Negotiation level, you know, the implicit negotiation is I'm going to be giving you information and you're going to be sitting and taking it in and trying to understand it. That I'm going to be in a teacher relationship, it's going to be a teacher-student relationship, and we're going to essentially negotiate it. Now, to the extent I can get you at some point, and I don't know, I have so much to say, I don't know, there may not be a lot of time for you to talk, but I may sometimes try to get you to talk. And that would be another negotiation. Are you going to be willing to participate in this with me or not? Or should it be just me talking? You feel what I'm saying? So there's these two communications are taking place at two levels. Those are two of the things I would say that I remember most from that book. And that was a long time ago when I read that. But I was absolutely fascinated by this experience. I ended up writing a 60-page paper on that experience. The longest paper I had written in undergraduate school was 12 pages long, typed, double-spaced. This is 60 pages. I couldn't believe I'd even written it. I still have it in my attic. So I became fascinated with this whole process. So when it came time to do my practicum, there was a center in Atlanta called the Bridge. Then it was called, when I did my practicum, it was called the Bridge for Runaways. Okay? And I knew about it, and I signed up to do my practicum there. Let me tell you a little bit about the Bridge. Okay, what had happened was, this is 1972 at this point. You all know anything about the 60s? Lord knows. But it was the 60s really were 1967. For white people, the 60s were 1967 to 1976. For black people, the civil rights movement was the first half of the 60s. But for white people, it was really, you know, the whole Haight-Ashbury, turn on, tune in, drop out. Any of you even heard of any of that?
Yes.
You're suffering from many of the whole hippie era. Okay.
Probably closer to my generation.
Right. It is, it's flat in my generation. These folks have never heard of any of that. Well, you've heard of hippies, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the center for that was Haight-Ashbury in California, but in the southeast, Atlanta, and particularly the Strip, a stretch from 7th Street to 14th Street on Peachtree Street, became a place where runaways from all over the southeast, where these kids were tuning in, turning on, and dropping out. And they were running away from home. And they were showing up on the Strip. And then these kids, these teenagers, were just, there they were, sleeping in doorways, scrounging food where they could, taking drugs. I mean, God knows what was going to anything goes. I actually lived not too far from there when I was in graduate school and saw all this happen. I couldn't really be accused of dropping out. If you're working on a PhD in psychology, you're truly not dropping, you don't qualify as having dropped out. But I saw all this going on. Well, what happened was two fellas, Greg Santos and, of course, now that I'm in front of you and I didn't write it down, because I thought I'd never forget it, now I've forgotten the person's name. You get old and, you know, my brother calls it old timers, you know, the name will just pop right out of your head. Anyway, two fellows in the counseling department at Georgia State, one of whom was Greg Santos, interestingly enough, a nun. There's a Trappist monastery outside of Atlanta in Conyers. And Greg had been a Trappist monk. Trappist is the most strict order of monastery in the Catholic Church. You can't speak at all. You just live there and you don't speak at all. Okay? Only the head monk or whatever is allowed to speak. Well, Greg managed to come out of the monastery and to get a degree in counseling at Georgia State University. He wandered around with Serapi and sandals on, and he wandered around with all these kids on the street, and Bob Griffin, that's the other name, Bob Griffin and Greg Sandals were wandering around. They said, somebody has to do something with all these kids. And so they started this idea that they would get the families of these kids, they would get them to fly in from wherever in the southeast they were, drive in or whatever, and they would meet with them, with the kids, because these kids were just living on the street. And the idea was to figure out what had happened that prompted them to run away and get that fixed and get them back home again. Okay, so that is how the bridge started. And I elected to do my practicum there. By the time I got there in 1972, what had happened is that other places were beginning to figure out that the bridge was working successfully with these kids. So suddenly, the juvenile courts started referring kids who were, because the juvenile court was already involved in runaways from the Atlanta area. They started referring kids who had other problems to the bridge, and school systems started referring kids to the bridge, and by the time I got there, it was really being converted to not so much the bridge for runaways. We changed its name to the Bridge Family Center, and it became the first place in Georgia to be working with whole families, is what happened. And that's why I went there, because I thought this was absolutely fascinating, as I already explained to you. So what happened was that we basically developed, I came there in the middle of the process, a model for working with families. It was a four-step model. I'll tell it to you briefly, and I'll tell you an irony of it. But I called it the magic string trick, the first part of it. That was not what the model was called. It was my name for it. If you know about, you've known about Carl Rogers, you've known about active listening, about reflecting, and so on, you know that? Well, the idea was that you would, they worked with the parents of the kids, and they're at odds. And you would listen to you would talk with the kid, but let's say the parent, I'm going to do the one, my favorite, we used to call them one-liners, and we'd teach this process by using one-liners. My favorite one-liner was, my daughter spends all her time locked in her room these days. If I had heard that once, I heard it 1,000 times from parents. Students. It doesn't happen anymore with kids. I don't know. Maybe they do. Maybe they still do that. I don't know. Now they just, it's just so weird. I think the world has gotten so weird. They just sit there and play video games. I don't know if girls do. Boys, that's all we do nowadays. But that wasn't back then. My daughter spends all the time locked in her room these days. Okay, and we would do what was called a content, then a feeling, and then what we called a flip side, reflection. Okay. In reflection. So the content reflection, you reflect back towards the person so they make an I statement. So my daughter spends all her time locked in a room these days. She's talking about daughter. You say back, so you don't get a chance to see your daughter hardly anymore. So now we're getting, so what I've done is I've moved the person from talking about the daughter to talking about herself, right? In the first reflection. She says, yes, I haven't gotten to talk. I hardly ever get to see her anymore. You listen for the feeling. In that statement, she gives you back something, you listen for the feeling, okay? And whatever the feeling is, you reflect that. So you say, it sounds like you really miss your daughter. Now, you miss being able to see her. Yeah, I really do miss her. You know, I used to spend all this time with her on it. And so then you do what we call a flip side. You would go from a complaint to a request, a want statement. So they'd say, well, I really miss her. I used to spend so much time with her, and now I don't get to see her anymore. And you would say, sounds like you really would like to spend more time with your daughter. Okay? So we've got content, feeling, flip side. So what I do is I build that. I do that with one, that's what I call the magic string tree. While I'm doing that, I'm building a relationship with that parent. Okay? Then I do the same thing with the kid. Listen to their complaint, do a content reflection, a feeling reflection, a flip side reflection. Now I've got a string between me and the kid, and now being the parent. Don't ever do anything until you've got both those people, what we call softened up, okay? Got them talking in a new way. And then, I would call it magic string tree, you tie the string together. You say, would you be willing to say that to your mother? Would you be willing to say that to your daughter? You know, I miss you, I'd like to see more. So, you see what I'm saying? So I call it the magic string tree. You build a string here, tie the string together, and you step out. And they're talking to each other. Okay? And that was the first part of it. That was the first part of it. And the essence of the model was, you then proceeded to start talking about the problem, whatever it is, and you would identify the problem, and then you get the parents to negotiate, and the kid, and so on. You get problem solved with them. But the idea was you didn't do anything. You didn't talk about the problem at all, or attempt problem solving until you've first done this relationship work. Okay? Magic string trick. You were going to
I was going to ask, if you do the four-step model with both present at the same time, so you would do it with the mom while the dog...
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. It was important. It was very important that they hear that. No. In our case, yeah, we always had the family in the room. The whole family was in the room at the time. Yeah, good point. I hadn't said that. So that's a very central point, yes. That model, by the way, the thing that most amazes me, and I have not been able to think of it as another old-timer's thing, emotionally focused couples therapy. What's her name?
Susan Johnson.
Susan Johnson. You heard of Susan Johnson, EFT, emotionally focused therapy? I mean, literally, this came around. She came out with this in about 2000, about the year 2000. It is exactly this model. It's with couples. She does it with a husband and wife. But it's just so weird, you know, like they say about the world, things just come around, you know. I mean, here I did all this, and when we traveled throughout, at this point, by the way, here I am 25 years old, or 26 years old. I've been at the bridge 1 year, and I am traveling not only around Georgia, training people to do this, but traveling around the Southeast, to North Carolina, and to Alabama, and to Tennessee, training people to do this, you know, because even though I've been doing it for only a year, I've been doing it a year longer than anybody else. So it was really a different experience. And also we became the place that graduate students, I remember I already came there for a practicum. So school from Georgia State, psych department, schools were already sent in, and it became the place where students from University of Georgia, Georgia State, Atlanta University, Emory, sent their practicum students to learn to work with families. We had two therapists in the room with every family. We had co-therapy. And then we would sometimes bring a student in as a third, or sometimes after the student got more familiar with it, as the co-therapist. And they would work with us with these families, and that was their, and we trained them in this model, and they learned to work in families. So that was, it was the place, it was the premier place at that point for training people to work with families. In the meantime, in the rest of the country, other people were working with families too. We were doing this literally on our own. We had no connection with what was going on in the rest of the country. But it turns out that in Wisconsin, there was Whitaker up there developing experiential therapy, okay, in Madison. And then in Philadelphia was Salvador Mnuchin, you've probably heard of, developing the Child Guidance Clinic. And in Philadelphia, was developing structural family therapy. And in Washington, Jay Haley was developing strategic therapy with kind of a weird kind of split. The people at MRI in California that we just talked about, Bates and Jackson, were kind of doing strategic too. I won't talk about them so much. But Haley was in Washington developing strategic therapy. And then Bowen, Murray Bowen, was in Washington developing what kind of is called Bowenian therapy. He had a name for it called, I think, General Systems Theory, something. It was a kind of a white bread name. It wasn't very distinctive, so people always just refer to it as Bowenian therapy. But these groups all started talking to each other, okay? And we started hearing about them, about what they were doing. And so then what happened over the next 5 years or so, is we began then to figure out what was going on in the rest of the country with family therapy. The first piece of that, that I, in terms of my experience, was American Academy of Psychotherapists is a professional organization. It's kind of on the touchy-feely end of the therapist world. In their journal, they publish poems, you know, and it's not like research articles. And they had their national convention conference in Atlanta in 1975, and Whitaker was coming down to be the headline presenter for 2 days. And the other people at the bridge didn't know about Whitaker. I knew about him from my time at Georgia State and from my work with Dick Feldman. Okay? So, and I knew about Roots of Therapy, Psychotherapy, I'd read it, and I said to the other people at the bridge, you need to see this guy. This guy is incredible. We all gotta go there. So we signed up. Here's a big room, 200 people. We're about two-thirds of the way back. And we spent the whole morning. There were seven of us who worked at the bridge, okay, working with these families. We've been working together this whole time. And so we're sitting there two-thirds of the way back, and there's Whitaker up on the stage, and the people are asking him, and you have to understand who Whitaker was. First of all, my brother, who's an engineer, saw him once at a conference. One of the times he came to Georgia was at the second GMFT conference, and my brother said he looked like a silverback goat. That was his image. He had very long arms and big hands. He grew up in a farming family in Pennsylvania, so he kind of looked like a farmer. He had a farmer's body, you know, and he's this big, and kind of little, and his silver hair. And my brother said it was like when he walked in the room, everybody acted like the silverback gorilla, you know, the top hierarchy gorilla had walked into the room. But he was this he lived his life experientially. It was all what was happening at the moment, okay? So he's up on this stage, and all these people are asking him these very academic-y, psychologist-y questions, and he's trying to answer them. He doesn't have a structured presentation because that's not Whitaker. Whitaker never wrote any books. The only articles I've ever read by him are really short, like a couple paragraphs. He never wrote anything. People followed around behind him writing down what he said, but he never wrote anything. And so he's up on the stage, and you can see him dying up there. Well, our group, remember I told you we're traveling all over the Southeast, training people to work with families. The way we trained was we would get the people, and let's say we've been sent, we were hired by Juvenile Justice in Georgia, we were hired by DFACS, we were hired by these places to go and train the workers in working with families. And we would get them to role play a family, and then we would demonstrate our model by working with that family in front of the whole group with them role playing family members. And by the way, we used to say that they would always, we said they, you know, there's games people play, the notion, there's a book back then called Games People Play, and it gave a name to all the little games that people played. And we used to call the game Stump the Bridge. They would come up with the sorriest family in the county. You know, they would put them up there and we'd try to work with them, try to stump us, you know. They were going to prove to us they had a family that was so hard to work with, we couldn't work with them, you know. And then we would work with the family. And we looked like heroes. It was great. So we used to, but that was our model for working with family, for training. So, but after lunch this first day, we all raised our hands simultaneously. We're two-thirds of the way back. We said, Dr. Whitaker, would you be willing to let us, there was a family that I and another woman there had been working with that were really stumping us. The girl was bulimic, but this is a long time ago. Before, there was no word to bulimia. There was no diagnosis of bulimia. We had a word anorexia. We didn't even know what bulimia was back then. It was brand new. I mean, we weren't figured out. But this girl was bulimic. I won't go into it, but it was really sad and troubling. It was just, I mean, she would eat all of the groceries for a family of four. The mother would shop on Friday afternoon, and by Saturday morning when they got to bed, she'd eaten the whole and vomited it all. And it was really, we were kind of stumped ourselves. So we raised our hand and we said, Dr. Whitaker, would you be willing to let us come up to the front and role play this family and you work with us so we could see what you're talking about? And Whitaker, like, he went, oh, it was like he almost agreed. He went, yes, now, come on, please. Because you know? He just said, I was dying on the stage. So he proceeds to work with us for the whole afternoon. Do a family therapy session with us, with this family. And the next morning, we come back in for the next day, and he's up there on the stage, and goes, those people from the bridge, are you all still, you know, would you come up on the stage and let me do some warm, you know? And it was just like, so what happened is he fell in love with us, we fell in love with him. What I discovered later is that we reminded him, remember APC and that whole group? and coming to Emory and developing a whole new model of therapy and all that. Well, I think what happened is we reminded him of them back then, and so as a result of that experience and me being essentially his client for this whole afternoon and morning, I played the father in the family. Was my first direct experience with Whitaker. The thing, if I want to talk about what is experiential therapy, I mean, it's so amorphous. You've already heard the notion of what happens in the room. What I would say was Whitaker's central notions, as I understood it, was what he called system flexibility. His assumption was the system was locked in a rigid pattern. And what you had to do was you had to do something to knock them off kilter. You had to somehow make the system. He used to say that people should be able to combine and recombine in all possible combinations without undue anxiety. Okay, that everybody should be able to interact with everybody without undue anxiety. And so he would do these things. I mean, to explain how he worked, first of all, he was an inveterate flirt. And I don't mean in the sexual sense, but just he would just flirt with the family. The other thing I say about Whitaker is I learned that I could just enjoy the family. He would just enjoy these people. His theory was they're not enjoying each other. And there was some family, the identified patient, he would always often say the identified patient was the hero. He would reframe them as the hero. This is, again, breaking down the rigid pattern, He would say, well, this kid, this symptom, he's trying to cure the family. He's trying to be a hero to cure this family. He'd relabel them that. And he would flirt with these people. He would do things to knock them off kilter. But it was all very spontaneous, all very experiential based. Now, his method was, you would always have to have the whole family in the room, okay? He talked about the battle for structure. If, as long as the way the family operates habitually is the way they operate in the room, no therapy has taken place, okay? You have to be the therapist, the one structuring what happens in the room, not the family. If you haven't won the battle for structure, if you're not in, then no therapy is occurring. That's what I'm saying? So you have to have something happen in the room different than what happens outside of the room. And his notion was that the person they don't want to bring is the key to the therapy. If they don't want to bring little Johnny or something who's not the symptom, you better darn well get little Johnny in there, because he's going to be the one who's going to make you suddenly a light bulb go off and realize what's going on in this family. Okay? To give you an idea of a Whitakerian intervention, my own experience, jumping ahead about 2 years. So in 1977, we have Whitaker come down to Georgia and spend 2 days at the Bridge. What we used to do, which I thought was a rather nifty trick, was if we wanted to learn about somebody's model of therapy, we would just hire them to come down to Georgia for 2 days. And we would do a one-day workshop, and we'd sell 25 tickets. And the 25 tickets would be enough to pay for the cost of bringing that person here and housing them. And then the second day, we would get them to ourselves. We would spend the second day with just the Bridge staff and this therapist. It was kind of it was smart, maybe a little slimy, but it was certainly a way to get an experience with these people. So we brought Whitaker there. So the first day, I'm charged with going to pick him up at the hotel, which is a couple blocks from the Bridge. Now, I was notorious for being chronically late. I would be late to final exams. I had teachers say, some teachers would let me stay late and finish the exam. Some would say, tough bananas, you're going to just stop on time, and if you don't have your exam finished, you're out of luck. And I was just chronically late, and I struggled with it. My theory about it at the time was, my mother was chronically late, and my theory was I'd never learned good punctuality habits. There's a lot of habits that go into being the punctual. It's a complex behavior. It's not just one thing. You have to do a lot of things to be punctual. That was my theory. But somehow I was never able to, I kept being chronically late. And so I show up to pick up Whitaker to take him over the Bridge, and I'm 15 minutes late. And I am mortified. I'm absolutely horrified that I have showed up 15 minutes late. I'm supposed to pick up like at 8 o'clock, and it's 8:15, and I'm showing up to Whitaker. And I come in, and I'm out of breath as usual when I'm late, and I'm apologetic and feeling shameful and all this business. And I say, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. He looks at me and says, oh, thank you so much. He said, my life is so ridiculously busy. Every minute is scheduled. And when somebody's late like this, I just got 15 minutes to just sit and relax. Thank you so much for being late. You know, and I'm like, this is like totally not, nobody has ever said that to me in all these years. And I stopped being late after that. And I thought about it, and I'm going to tell you, I still can't figure out, how did he do that? That doesn't, now it's a classic Whittakerian, right? You get an intervention, but I didn't understand, how did that work? How did that work? And I didn't figure out till 5 years ago, I finally figured out why that worked. I never could, why did that? That can't be. That doesn't make any sense. You just do that and I'd stop being late, right? How can you explain it? What I now, and I have to tell you more about me than you maybe want to know, but I grew up, again, my mother was always late. And my mother, consequently, I was always, and everybody in our family was always waiting. We were always waiting. And sometimes the waiting was particularly painful. I grew up in the Chicago area, okay? Junior high, okay, when I went to junior high. In the winter in Chicago, and winter in Chicago is brutal. In the winter in Chicago, it starts to get dark about 4 o'clock. It starts getting dark an hour earlier than here because they're right on the other side of the timeline. You know, we're on the western edge of the eastern time zone. They're the eastern edge of the central time zone. So for all practical purposes, it's the same sometime. So there, it starts to get dark at about 4 o'clock. Well, school would let out at 3:15. And my brother and I would be running around the playground with the other kids from 3:15 to 3:30 playing. And then by 3:30, they're all pretty much starting to go home and the buses are leaving. And by like 3:45, we're the only kids left. And somehow, it seemed a lot warmer when there were a lot of other kids there and we were playing. And now we're standing there and we're trying to, and the sun is going down and we're standing in the corner trying to get out of the wind and we're shivering and we're miserable and we're sitting there like that. And finally, my mother shows up at like 4 o'clock. Oh, I was just on the phone with so-and-so and I just, you know, and just happy. And we're like, the only time I ever ran away from home, one day she did that. And I said, can't you just be on time? And she said, you don't like it, walk. I opened the door and walked. I walked and I walked and I walked all evening and all night and finally came back to the school in the middle of the night and broke into the school and slept in one of the classrooms. They showed up the next morning and there I was. I was so proud of myself. I'd gone to the bathroom at the school and washed up my face and all that. And I was sitting there ready to go to school. Inside the night watchman had come around the school and I just hid under the teacher's desk. You know, and so that was my runaway experience. And by the way, my mother started being more punctual after that. But because they were horrified, they were freaked out. I didn't know what happened to me. And but the point was that waiting on people who were late, waiting was always this almost post-traumatic experience. This is what I figured out 5 years ago, was this post-traumatic experience for me. And so I was always planning to get somewhere right at the agreed upon time. You know, if I was supposed to be somewhere at 4, I was planning a bit of, in order to avoid waiting. I spent my life trying to avoid waiting because it was this painful, traumatic kind of back, you know, experience. Well, if you always plan to be on time, you're going to be late 33% of the time because stuff happens. Something's going to go wrong. If you're going to be on time, you have to plan to be there early. And what Whittaker did, and it only dawned on me, all of a sudden it gave me a whole new model. I could say, oh, I could just relax and enjoy myself. My life was real busy too. I could just, he gave me a whole new way of thinking of it, and it didn't dawn on me why it worked until like 5 years ago. And ever since then, now, I got here early today, and I went down to your little cafe, found your little cafeteria, and had some bagel and cream cheese and some Sprite, and relaxed, and, you know, no anxiety, and, you know, it was a different experience. So the point was, but that's his intervention. That's my story, my Whittaker story about the intervention with Whittaker that he did. And I can tell other Whittaker stories. He was really an incredible character. But enough of that. His wife, Muriel, one of my favorite things, she had one earring that said in and the other earring said out. And it's very disconcerting to talk to somebody whose earring said in That was a Muriel story. It's very disconcerting. And I'm like, look, all of a sudden I realized that earring says in and that earring says out. So anyway, but back to the history of family therapy in Georgia. So about that same time, 75, we had Whittaker come to the Ridge. He really influenced our work, and therefore the training we were doing was influenced by what we learned from him. At the same time, one of the people at the Bridge named Sylvia went off to, in 76, She went off to Philadelphia for a month-long training program. They had these month-long training programs that they would teach people to do structural family therapy. And she spent a month in Philadelphia and came back and taught us about structural family therapy, Mnuchin. And you've heard about some of that. I will say that in terms of trying to summarize structural therapy, there's in a few sentences, summarize any of these is pretty ludicrous, but he was really focused on hierarchy. He was very aware of hierarchy and hierarchy inversions in the family. And if there was a hierarchy inversion, that means basically the kids were running the show instead of the parents. And his method was to what he called enactments. You'd bring the family into the room, and you would have them, you would coach them through the process of doing it differently than they do it at home. Okay? So you would enact, you would have a different experience of how to interact. He would structure structural family. He would structure their interactions in a different way than the interactions they were having at home. Okay? A quick example in my case with hierarchy and structure. This is not something that was done with me, but one of the first clients I was working with after I learned this, this mother, single parent, comes in with this little six-year-old kid. And of course, this would happen a lot to us. This little six-year-old kid is terrifying, terrorizing her. He's running the whole house. He's in charge of all this, terrorizing this mother. She comes to see us. And so I'm meeting with them. And we had, at the bridge, we would meet upstairs with the clients in these treatment rooms. And downstairs in the waiting room, there was a Coke machine. And back then, Cokes were like, it was either a dime or a quarter, I can't remember, some small amount of money. And the kid says, and by the way, don't ever have a Coke machine in your therapy center. Back then it was bottles, right? And so I'm dating myself. Our carpets were so disgusting from spilled Cokes. I mean, it was just terrible. So don't ever do that. I learned my lesson, don't ever have a Coke machine. But we had a Coke machine, and the kid says, gets up in the session, I want to go downstairs and get a Coke. This is so many years ago, I don't know where he got the money, but he must have had the money in his pocket, he says. And she, mother said, no, don't. And the kid just kept on going. Just ignored her as we walk out the room. Well, I don't know if Mnuchin would have done this. I don't remember Mnuchin enough to know whether he would have ever himself first modeled the interaction or if he would only have coached the mother to do it. I can't remember. But what I did was I just pulled my chair over in front of the door. I just sat in front of the door. The reason I remember this was that little six-year-old kid, he had cowboy boots on. I would have sworn to God those soles were this thick. I swear to God. And that kid kicked me and just kicked the holy out of me. And I went home that night, and I had black and blue marks up and down my shin. They were just black. With those cobwebs. But I just kept my chair in front of the door, and the kid didn't leave the room. You know? And that's a structural intervention. That's an enactment. You see what I'm saying? This was the mother. Because she said, what can I do? I can't make him. He just does what he wants to do. That's pretty much it. So there's an example of that. With a little bit of the Purple Heart family therapy. That was in 1976. Around 1976 also, a woman named Carol Damon is brought to Georgia State University into the psychology department to develop a family therapy wing to the psychology program at Georgia State University. Okay. A family therapy training program. And Carol is from Washington, and she had worked with Jay Haley, specifically. So Carol basically brought strategic therapy to Georgia, okay? I didn't know anything about strategic therapy. I don't know that anybody, I'm sure people were reading these books, but to me, that's what not really matters. What really matters is when somebody begins to bring the presence here to Georgia and beginning to train people in doing it. So Carol comes and she, in addition to the program at Georgia State, she starts a practice. And it was the Atlanta Institute for Family Studies. What was it, Atlanta
Institute? Atlanta Institute for Family Studies.
Studies, that's what I said.
Got her certificate there.
Atlanta Institute for Family Studies. And she brings together practitioners from, not from here in Georgia, she brought them from somewhere else, to be faculty at Georgia State and to practice at the Atlanta Institute for Family Studies. And that became the training center for strategic therapy in Georgia. Okay, so she really brought Haley's ideas to Georgia. In terms of what that meant, and in terms of my, I was never particularly involved. I did some workshops with Carolyn, I got to know her, but I was never particularly involved in that approach. I traveled to Washington, I saw Haley, went to a two-day workshop with him, read some of his books. Strategic therapy, I suppose in the simplest way, in people's minds, it's identified with paradoxical interventions. Did you say, people think of that as paradoxical. I think that's a way oversimplification of what strategic therapy is. Strategic therapy is really about figuring out, in my opinion, it's about figuring out what the function, the purpose of the symptom is, and then in some way prescribing something around the function of that symptom. You follow what I'm saying? So the therapist figures that out and then gives a prescription. Sometimes the paradoxical intervention is to prescribe the symptom. You actually tell them to go home and do the thing that's the symptom, and you actually make it a prescription. Okay, but it's not always that way.
I was just going to ask you, in terms of ethics, do you feel that the directive interventions, like you're describing, that are they ethical in your opinion?
Well, there was some question about that back then. If it's done clumsily, no. But if it's done skillfully, yes. I'll tell you a quick story about that in a minute. But I'm going to tell you my story about my experience with that. I don't think I'm supposed to do that. It's probably making a bunch of noise on the microphone. But an example, by the way, the book that Haley wrote that influenced me the most was a book called Problem Solving Therapy. Okay, and basically what he said was, remember the bridge model? Did all this communication stuff before you even talked about the problem? Haley, exact opposite. Haley said, you start off by asking them what's the problem, and then that's the thing he says they have an incentive to work on. And you mobilize that incentive. You use the problem as leverage, but your prescription is designed to change. You have a theory about what's wrong in the family system, and your prescription is designed to change the family system, but you use the problem as your leverage to get them to actually do it. Okay? Is that making sense? So I'm going to tell you a quick story about that, and I'll tell you an ethical story early on when I learned to do this, there was a family who was sent to me, and this kid, this is one of the most, you have these certain clients and experiences that you'll never forget as long as you live, like all the shin, kicked up shins. This kid had stopped going to school. He had not been to school for several months. I can't remember now how many months. Haley would have talked about that in his book, and he said he would call it school phobia. Now, there were all kinds of other explanations people had, but he would frame it as a phobia. He would say it's a phobia, and like with any other phobia, like if you fall off a horse, the best thing to do is get back up on the horse, right? He said what you need to do is just get this kid going to school. So what I did, and the model was that you would go to the school, and you would have, I did this, I had a meeting with all the teachers, I called the counselor, said I want a meeting with all the teachers. Every one of his teachers had to be there, every one of them. And I told them, on such and such a date, we're gonna get this big kid back in the classroom, and I don't want you to shame him, I don't want you to act weird, I don't want you to say, what happened to you, how come you weren't here for 2 months? Just accept him back in the classroom. Don't make a big deal of it, and prevent any of the kids from doing that. You don't wanna have this be a negative experience for him. You wanna just welcome him back. Okay, get that set up in advance, and then I would get this family. Now, what's actually going on in this family was, fascinating experience. This family was from Korea, the parents were from Korea, and then they'd gone to Japan, and they'd come to the United States. And the father only spoke Japanese and Korean. He ran a Chinese restaurant. The mother was bilingual, spoke English, when I say bilingual, maybe trilingual. She spoke Japanese and Korean and English. The older sister spoke, she was bilingual, she spoke English and Japanese and Korean. And the boy, my client, only spoke English. So get this, the father and the boy can't talk to each other because they don't speak the same language. The father doesn't speak English and the boy doesn't speak, Japanese or Korean. And the father's gone all day long because this restaurant it's like, that's their, and he's like, opens his restaurant, like opens it, I don't know what time of the morning, but he's there all day long. He doesn't get home till the kid's in bed. So the boy never sees his father. And in the Oriental culture, women don't tell men what to do. Okay, men tell women what to do. So when this boy, who now becomes a teenager, stands up and says, I'm not going to school, she just defers. You follow? That's actually what's going on in the family, what I figured out. Okay? So I'm using Haley's intervention, and I say, so I tell the family, you know, I told them the whole plan, we met with the teachers, and we said on such and such a date, this kid's going to school. So I have the kid now scheduled to come to my office the day before the first day he's going to school. And the kid does, fairly predictable, what do you think he does?
No,
he doesn't show up. They call me up on the phone, and they say he's refusing to come. And what I do, this is before cell phones, I'm just talking to the phone. And I'm talking to them, and I'm saying, okay, what I want you to do, now, I said the father was going to be there for the session. So the father is away from the restaurant. I say to the father, I want you to pick this kid up and bring him to my office. I want you to just pick him up, the two of you together, and just bodily bring him to my office. So they pick him up. My favorite thing, as I'm talking to them, at some point, they arrive at the office, the way the... Were you at the family workshop?
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was a parking lot behind, and there was a deck. It was a big old house that was converted to offices. And there was some stairs up to the deck, and then you went in the deck. On the deck, you went into a screen porch, and from the screen porch, you came into the waiting room. And I remember this kid. It's just this kid in his pajamas. He's horizontal. The mother and the father have each got him by his legs and by his chest, and the kid's arms are like this, out of the screen door thing. He's horizontal, trying to hold on, and they're pulling him, you know, gradually. And finally, they get them and plop him down in my office just about the time that the session's over with, just about the time the hour's over with. And what I said to the parents, what I said was, great, you've done perfect. You've got the kid here. Kudos. You deserve a medal. Now, I want you to do the exact same thing tomorrow. You know? And if he is in his pajamas, take him to school in his pajamas. Doesn't matter. Okay? Just you take him to school as planned. Guess what happened the next morning? Yes. That kid was not in his pajamas. I guarantee you, because they knew he was going to do it. They were going to do it. That kid was sitting there dressed and ready to go. And he went to school. And I saw them for a couple more, you know, for a while. And he gradually got back. And the rest of it is just it all unfolded from there. Now, when you talk about the ethics and doing it clumsily, ever heard of a guy named Hinckley? What was Hinckley's first name?
Great. Was it Great?
Pardon?
Great?
No, it wasn't Great. Hinckley. Does that ring any bells? Maybe you all are too young.
The assassin?
Pardon?
Didn't he shoot somebody?
Ronald Reagan. Okay. He shot Ronald Reagan. Okay. He's still in a psychiatric hospital. Okay. He was just recently released, maybe. I can't remember. It was in the news. Something like that. Hinckley. Ronald Reagan, remember the assassination attempt on Ronald Reagan? Haley wrote a book called Leaving Home. And what he said was basically, I mean, it was a little hokey, but he said a lot of schizophrenia and manic depression and all these illnesses that have onset about 19 to 21 were all about leaving home. And he said, basically what he said was kids were not leaving home. And what you needed to do is you needed to structure, the parents needed to structure the process of the kid leaving home. You needed to be in charge and oversee a stepwise process of the kid doing the things necessary to leave home. Okay? He wrote this book. Well, this psychiatrist out in Colorado essentially misunderstood or misread or didn't bother to read the book or something, Haley. And he just coached the family to just kick him out. And they just bought him a ticket on an airplane and he flew to Washington, D.C. and shot Reagan. And it was some stir in the family therapy field. Because this guy had based his intervention on this book by Haley called Leaving Home, but what he'd done is he'd misapplied it. He hadn't understood it. You follow what I'm saying? And I think that you could say that there was the country suffered the result of that misapplication. It all comes down to whether you really understand it and know what you're doing and do it well, you know, prescribing the symptom. I'm going to do history of family therapy. I could tell other stories about the later thing, but one quick one. This is not exactly a Haley intervention, although similar. When I was first at the Bridge, we founded a group home. Originally, we did not. Other runaway centers in the country were housing runaways. runaways. The bridge refused to house runaways. Our deal was to get the families in, meet them with them, and get them home. Okay? So we deliberately did not house them, unlike most runaway centers in the rest of the country. But we did at some point, there was a place in Georgia called the truck stop. Back then, the phrase was keep on trucking. Hippie phrase, keep on trucking, so the truck stop, get it, was there. And so they did house these kids, and it became ultimately part of the Bridge Corporation. But the deal was kids would go to the truck stop as a group home, but they could never stay there for the weekend. From the very first week they stayed there, or after the first week they stayed there, they would go home every week for the weekend, and all residents of the truck stop would have to come to the Bridge and do family therapy with the families. And the idea was that if you just put kids in a hospital and then you get them better, then they send them home, and if home hasn't changed, then nothing's ever any better. You know? So the idea was that we'd be working with the families. So that if this kid comes in to see me, this family comes in to see me, and they've got this little girl, she's 13 years old, and she's about this tall, she's this petite, and she was running away from home. And back then, raves were the big thing. You ever heard of raves? Or maybe they even exist still. You know, raves and these big warehouses, and they would have all this music and drugs and all that. They'd run out of these warehouses and there'd be all this music and drugs. And these were happening in downtown in some kind of rough parts of town in Atlanta, these warehouses. And they came to see me, and this girl was running away, and they were going home. The kid had to be home for the first weekend. And I was not willing to, I mean, that kid would end up dead or something, raped. God knows, she's 13 years old, she's running away, she's sneaking out in the middle of the night and going to these raves. And I'm thinking, yikes, on my watch, I don't want to have a kid killed or raped or anything. So I said to the family, what I want you to do is when she goes to bed at night, I want you to go out and buy some handcuffs, and I want you to handcuff her ankle to the bedpost so she can't leave. Well, this little social work student, some of you are social work, they had these social work students coming and doing internships at the practicum placements at the truck stop. And there was this little social worker who was the young woman who brought the kid from the truck stop over to the family therapy session and back again. And she's sitting there, and I thought she was going to pass. I mean, her face turned white. She was horrified that I was saying they were going to handcuffs on this kid. And she said, you can't do that. That's unethical. She said, you can't do that. That's unethical. And I said, it's a whole lot more unethical. She's dead. You know? And what ended up happening, the family negotiated, we discussed it, and they ended up deciding that they nailed shut her bedroom windows, and they put a lock in the door that could be locked from outside the door. They didn't handcuff her, okay? But my point was that they needed to do something. It was a structural intervention, you know? They needed to do something to make sure that they were in charge of this kid wasn't running away anymore. You follow? So, I mean, by the way, you all are going to be looking at the ethics codes for what they're worth, right? Mm-hmm. When you look at the ethics code for the composite board, I was one of three people who wrote that, and then I was one of a committee of eight people who revised it 10 years later. So if you want to know what my values are about ethics, just look at the composite board ethics code. Because when you get to write the code of ethics, guess what? You get to have you get to have your own values, the ones that everybody has to follow. That's what I mean. You'll notice, by the way, that the composite board's ethics code doesn't say you have to have a written release before you can disclose information to the client. Because a lot of codes say that. My opinion is that sometimes in emergency situations, you have to get a verbal release and you get the written one later. So you'll notice that. That's just one of my own little opinions. But if you get to write the code, you get to kind of say what you wanted to say. So anyway, my values are all in that code. So anyway, I'm starting to get behind time. I better get going here. So that's my example of a strategic invention, the kid with the school phobia. Bowen. So what happened, jumping ahead a little bit, remember Carol Damon came into Atlanta? She starts the Atlanta Institute for Family Studies. It becomes the other kind of competing center for training therapists. The Bridge, we were doing really experiential and structural. She was doing strategic. And she brought, there was another place in the country, in Westchester County, north of New York, where there was a center, I don't remember the name of the center, but Phil Guerin and Tom Fogarty were the people who worked out of that center. And they were the other premier place doing Bowenian therapy in the country. And Carroll actually brought Garen and Fogarty and the other people at his center to Atlanta for 4 months straight, 1 weekend a month for 4 months straight. And anybody who was almost anybody in family therapy in Atlanta went to this thing and just spent a weekend once a month for 4 months learning about Goini family therapy. I saw the little thing you had up on the thing, and I was about to say, I was happy to see that the two top points were differentiation and triangulation, because I was about to say, if I'm to summarize Goinian, I think the two central notions are triangulation. You apparently now know what that is, right? What triangulation is. And differentiation, so you have an idea what differentiation is? By the way, Bowen was initially a biologist, and the notion of differentiation, or he, he was schooled in biology, I can't remember now, I'm maybe getting mixed up with somebody else. But differentiation is actually a concept out of biology. A single-celled animal is essentially undifferentiated. The more complex the organism gets, the more differentiated. By the time you get to a human being, you've got a skeletal system, a nervous system, a muscular system, a digestive system. It's very different, with different functions being performed by different systems within the organism. One-celled animal, just, you know, one cell, you know, not differentiated. But differentiation also implies separating. When you differentiate, you separate, okay? And his notion combines those two definitions of differentiation. The notion that the more complex, the more differentiated the individual becomes, that is, in psychological terms, the more skills they've developed to survive in the world, the more they're able to separate from their family and become an autonomous, successful individual. So that's the concept of differentiation. And one of the things that, and talk about methods, Bowen, his method, one of his methods, well, two things I'd say about his method. Number one, he often worked with just individuals. If there was a child problem in the family, he often would never even see the child. He'd just bring the parents in, okay? It was called Bowenian coaching. Unlike Whitaker, unlike Mnuchin, Haley would often just want to see the parents and the identified patient. Bowen would not, he was the one who originated the idea that you could do family therapy with an individual. Okay? And one of the first things he'd do is put their genogram on a poster or piece of paper or whatever, big piece of, what do you call that?
Newsprint.
Words. And he'd do that. And then he would look, and the notion was that especially, he'd look for all kinds of things. But one of the things he'd most look for was cutoffs, where people were cut off from each other. And his assumption is that that would be a block to differentiation in some way. He'd look for cutoffs. I want to tell my story. So Carol Davin brings Garen and Fogarty to Atlanta for 4 weekends, once a month for 4 months. And one of the things they did as this training progressed was they had broke us up into small groups, and we put our genograms up on the board. So I'm up there and I put my genogram up, and they took one look at my genogram and they said, you need to get to know your father. My story was that my parents were divorced when I was 5 years old. My mother remarried when I was 8. My father was in the military, in the Navy. He was really in Japan and then Vietnam most of the time I was growing up. And my parents made the decision, it was their idea of trying to be helpful, that my brother and I would connect more with my stepfather if we didn't have anything to do with our father. So basically, I only saw my father 3 times between the time my parents were divorced at age 5 until I was 30 years old, or thereabouts, when I was in this workshop with Bowen. So I really did not know my father. I actually had gotten a picture of him somewhere. He used to send us money for Christmas presents at Christmas time when we'd buy stuff. And I had a picture of him, which I kept in my sweater drawer. If you're in Chicago, you have a sweater drawer. And I kept that picture there. But that was it, you know. But these people took one look at my genogram and said, you need to get to know your father. And I proceeded to go on a hunt. By the way, you introduced me as Carl Johnson. That was my stepfather's name, not surprisingly, since the whole family theory was that we'd be connected to our stepfather. My father's name is Kronemuller. My actual birth name is Carl Friedrich Kronemuller III. It's a very military German name. And Cardinal is a pretty unusual name. And I knew it, all I knew was, I knew he was in California somewhere. And I knew that my uncle, his brother, was a doctor and he lived in LA somewhere. So I just, back then, you just would call him area directory assistants. Turns out there were like 7 different area codes in LA, I didn't know that. And I had to go to separate directory assistants, but I knew his name was Philip Cronemiller, he was a doctor. And I just started calling California and asking for directory assistants, do you have a doctor whose name is Philip Cronemiller? And I found him. I got on the phone and I said who I was, and I said, do you know where my father is? And he told me where he was, and I got his number, and I called him up. And he came to Georgia, and my brother had actually met him before. My brother had been in the military, and had been in California, met him when he was in the military. But I didn't know at all. And the thing I would say about that, first off, I was terrified to meet him. My brother and he had hit it off. My brother was in the military. My brother and I are opposites. My theory was that my brother got along with him, and they felt so similar that he must be opposite to me, and he and I aren't going to get along. It was my theory, my fear. I remember I was doing a workshop. Remember, we were traveling all over the Southeast doing. I was doing a workshop in Savannah, doing some training about family therapy, and my sister-in-law called me up the phone and said, "Your father's in town. You need to take the early plane home." And I said, I thought she meant my stepfather. I said, "What's he doing here?" No, your father. We called him in my family. We called him the commander. He was a retired commander in the Navy at this point. My mother always referred to him as the commander. Gus Napier, you're going to hear about in a minute, used to think it was so funny that I had a father he called the commander. And he said, no, I mean the commander. And I'm like, oh, yikes. You know, I remember getting on the plane, coming back, and I don't perspire all that much. I had sweat running down. And I was so nervous about being there. And I go to a restaurant, and there he is. He's sitting across the table from me and my brother. And it was the most amazing experience. Now, mind you, most people have met their father, so they probably don't have a lot of sense of this, but I just thought I was me. I just think I fell out of the sky, you know? If you knew your father, you'd probably see ways in which you're similar to your father, but I didn't have that experience, you know? And I'm sitting across the table from this guy, and one minute he's saying something that reminds me exactly of my brother, and the next minute he's saying something that reminds me exactly of me. And I'm listening. I'm a therapist at this point. I'm listening to him talking. Oh my God, he thinks like I think. His brain lurks like my brain works, you know? I tend to think in outlines. And here's this guy sitting at the card table, and it's clear he thinks in outlines, you know? And I'm like blown away. Well, my family had always been, my parents couldn't manage money to save their souls. They were always kind of on the edge, even though both my parents worked, in an era where mothers didn't work. We should have had plenty of money, but it was just terribly managed, and we were always just, my father was kind of a really, my stepfather was a sweet guy, but when he wasn't working, he wanted to be down in the basement tinkering in his little shop, you know. The commander was a very different person. When he retired from the Navy, he started investing money, and he made a bunch of money in investing. And he was a kind of dynamic person. He was a commander. I mean, he was, and my whole sense of myself changed getting to know him, you know. I just hadn't conceived of myself in certain ways, you know. I mean, the reason I can work now, I work half-time, my practice now is half-time practice. I can do that because, you know, the commander said, you need to start investing money, you know, and he said he was going to give us some money to invest, and he said, you know, it's not for you to live on, you're to invest it for two purposes, and you need to invest in yourself. That was part of how I decided to go in private practice and work with Gus. He said, you need to get into practice, you need to buy your own building, that's what you need to do. You need to invest in yourself, invest in the stock market. I'm not sure I could have done the work that I did in the legislature if it hadn't been for my sense of myself changing from meeting my father. You follow what I'm saying? So that's my story about the Lean intervention with genograms and how it affected me personally. Good God, we've got not many much time left. Carol Dammann brought Bowen to Atlanta. The rest of this I'm going to go over really fast. Okay, because I'm really behind, and we've only got 10 more minutes, and I'm supposed to finish up at 45 after. What happened then, two things I'll summarize. Gus Napier, who had worked with Carl Whitaker from Wisconsin, and Gus Napier wrote a book called The Family Crucible, And The Crucible was a book that every graduate student in family therapy in the country read at that point. And Gus grew up in Lumber City, Georgia, but went off to school went to graduate school in North Carolina, and then went to do his residency with Whitaker up in Wisconsin. Gus moved back to Atlanta. Whitaker said, you've got to look up these people at the bridge. They're doing family therapy. When Gus came, we had him come over the bridge. We had him spend a day with us. Whitaker, when he came that in 1977, and he thought we were so much like he was when he was young. At one point, he gets up in the middle of the day, walks over to the blackboard, and writes, suicide is inevitable, on the board, and sits down. Doesn't say a word. Just walks up and down. We're like, what? What is that? You know? And I don't remember what he said. This is a long time ago. This is 1977. But what I realized then and is that he was talking about our group, that just like their group, APC broke up at one point, finally. He was saying that this group was destined to break up at the bridge. And in fact, in 1980, we all went our separate ways. Myself and Gene and Sylvia were looking for an office space near where we lived, and we found out that Gus was looking for office space in the same place. And we called him up, and we said, Gus, why don't we do this together? And he said, great. And we started a place called the Family Workshop. And that's where I worked. So we had the Family Workshop. Carol had the Atlanta Institute for Family Studies. There was also a guy named Frank Pittman, who I was going to tell you more about. He was the other nationally famous therapist in Atlanta. Frank just loved being outrageous. Frank was one of the people who did the early research in the 1960s out in Colorado, where they put patients in a control group and an experimental group. The control group, they sent them to the hospital when somebody in the family went psychotic. And the experimental group, they had a family therapist go to the house and work with them. Therapist. And they followed up on these people and found out the recidivism rate was almost nothing for the family therapy group and the other group. Within a short period of time, somebody would be rehospitalized. It was some of the first work in family therapy in the country. Frank had done that research. He moved back to Atlanta. He was an outrageous guy. He used to say, we therapists have convinced people, he loved saying outrageous things to get people angry. He said, we therapists have convinced people that their feelings are important. He said, their feelings aren't important. He says, I listen to their feelings for half the session because that's what they're paying me to do. And then the second half of the session, I tell them what to do. I tell them to do the common sense thing. And he said, I would have done that for free anyway. That's what he said. And he said, then if they do the common sense thing, they'll get better. And if they don't do the common sense thing, you analyze the resistance. That was his approach, but that was Pittman. Anyway, so these three places in Atlanta were the places where most of the training of family therapists were happening in the state of Georgia. But then, in the mid-80s, something changed in the entire country. Up to then, psychologists, social workers, even counselors, were trained according to what was called an educational model. There were graduate degree programs in psychology, in social work, and counseling. There weren't any in marriage and family therapy. Marriage and family therapy, people became a marriage and family therapist through an apprenticeship model. You got a degree in psychology, like I did, or in social work, or in counseling, or something else, psychiatry even, and then you found a family therapist to mentor you, and that person became your supervisor. And that's why the training in family therapists was occurring at the Family Workshop and at the Family Institute, with Pittman doing supervision. But what happened was, all over the country, AAMFT nationally was saying to people, we need to start having graduate degree programs in family therapy. And so, in Georgia, first, and I don't know the year, when did Karen Wampler come here?
1981, 82.
So, here in University of Georgia, there was essentially, it was a home ed department to start with, mm-hmm. And then it's now called Consumer Sciences or something, but it was really
called Family Consumer Sciences.
Yeah, but it was really a home economics department. And they had courses in child development as part of home economics, but it was child development. Well, they brought Karen Wampler here to develop a doctoral program in family therapy. Okay, in Macon, Mercer University had a medical school that was family medicine. Okay, they were training family practitioners, and they wanted these family practitioners to know something about family therapy. Okay, so they brought Marianne Armour from Alabama, and brought her in about 1985, thereabouts, mm-hmm. I guess, and she started a family therapy master's degree program at Mercer University in Macon, which now has a branch of Atlanta. Okay. And then at Valdosta State University in the sociology department, this is a very checkered story, but there was a guy named John Curtis who was the chairman of the sociology department, and he started teaching some family therapy courses, kind of like you all are doing, a post-master's certification in family therapy for people who had master's degrees in sociology. But what happened was at some point, John Curtis left, and they brought a woman named Carmen Knudsen Martin, who now is out at, last I heard, Loma Linda in California. She's still around. But she was brought to Georgia to develop a family therapy program at Valdosta State University. So now, most of the, and the family workshop continued to do what we did. And Carol eventually left the Atlanta Institute and just opened a private practice. And Gus eventually retired. And the family therapy training is now done at University of Georgia and at Mercer and Valdosta State here in Georgia. So that's how family therapy is. People are now being trained as family therapists. So the exciting era back then of us learning as we went along, all that is pretty much changed. And that's my talk on the history of the practice of family therapy. Now I'm going to talk about the history of the regulation of family therapy, and I've got supposedly 2.5 minutes to go. Can you guys wait like a few minutes, or we have to stop absolutely?
Can we go to 4:50?
Yeah.
4:50, okay. So I'm going to say this all really fast. What happened was in 1977, counselors and social workers, I think just social workers to start with, were trying to get a law license in social workers through the legislature in Georgia. And they weren't getting anywhere. And then a guy named Jim Kilgore came along, a minister up in Alpharetta, and his brother, he was practicing family therapy, and his cousin was a legislator, representative of the Georgia Representative. So he goes, Jim Kilgore founds the Georgia Association for Marriage and Family Therapy in 1977, incorporates it, and gets his brother to introduce a bill licensing marriage and family counselors, it was called. Okay? I don't know the number, but it was probably, there were probably only, I know there was a license in California, there was a license in New Jersey, maybe even the third one in the country, I don't know. It was very, very new. But Georgia has a law called, a sunset law. It says that at the longest every 6 years, every licensing board would have to come before the legislature and be renewed, or else it would be automatically sunset. Okay. And I think the MFC licensing board maybe had a 3-year sunset clause, because the next thing I know, in 1980, it's coming up for renewal, and the counselors are trying to get a law licensing counselors to the legislature, and they object to the fact that our law said marriage and family counselors, and their law that they were trying to get through said that marriage and family counseling board would be a subpart of a professional counseling board. And so, we opposed that. They opposed the renewal of our board. Their bill failed. Our bill failed. The board went out of existence. And a guy named Culver Kidd, who is the chairman of the Governmental Operations Committee of the Senate, said, "We are sick of you all having your turf fight down here in our legislature. When you all three, social workers, counselors, marriage and family therapists, can come up with something you can all three support, then come back and talk to us, not until then." So what happened was, I had just started my private practice, 1980. And I had a lot of free time. No money, no clients, I had a lot of free time. And so remember Sylvia, euphemism for unemployed. So I was always fascinated by legislative stuff. So I raised my hand at a chapter meeting, and I started going they formed a chapter, Atlanta chapter of the Georgia Association for Marriage and Family Therapy. I raised my hand and said, because the people who'd been working on the law up to then were tired, and really they'd blown it also, to be quite frank, that the thing had failed. They lost. And they said, who would like, and I raised my hand and said, I'll do it. And actually Sylvia, and I remember one of the key moments of my life, we were walking into this meeting and there was two sets of doors, and I said, Sylvia, if we walk through those doors, we're making a commitment that's going to be a long-term commitment.
That was what year?
That was September 1980.
36 years ago.
Yeah, no kidding. So what happened was I then coordinated, I then negotiated for the marriage and family therapists among these three groups. We came up with a bill eventually after talking for a year about it. Then the group elected me to be the coordinator for the three groups because we hired a lobbyist and he said, I don't want to be dealing with three point people, I want one point person. So the group selected me because I was fascinated by the legislature. But I worked with him and it took 4 years to get that licensing law through the legislature. And in 1985, the law was formed and I got on the board. But it's never as simple as that. Because, for instance, we'll skip the law that we originally passed was a title protection law, not a practice protection law. It said that anybody could do these activities, social work, counseling, marriage and family therapy, but only licensed people could use the title, marriage and family therapy, social work, professional counseling. Well, then the Florida, in Florida, a suit was brought by a group who called themselves psychologists. They were practicing, but they were not licensed as psychologists, but they wanted to practice it. And they brought a suit saying that it was an unconstitutional violation of commercial free speech. Their legal theory was that if you're allowed to do the activity in the United States of America, you can't be told, you can't say you do the activity. It's a violation of free speech. And went all the way to the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals, and the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals declared title protection laws unconstitutional as a violation of commercial free speech. So suddenly, the 11th Circuit, Florida, Georgia, and Alabama, our licensing law was now declared unconstitutional. We saw it as an opportunity. The nationals, dumb, didn't. They could have appealed to the Supreme Court, but they didn't want to do that because they didn't want to have all the title protection laws across the country declared unconstitutional. We said, perfect. We went to the legislature and we said, we joined up with the psychologists because the psychologist law was also a private protection law. And together, we redrafted our laws as practice protection laws, and we went to the legislature and said, sorry, the courts made us do it. You know, you guys got to pass this law because the court says that our law is unconstitutional. And I don't think we could have gotten it through the legislature without that, but, you know, they did it. So now the law you have is a practice protection act. You can't practice these activities or use these titles unless you're licensed. And that's not the way it is in the whole country. But then there's more, two more minutes. There's just a series. Once you get a law in, it's just one thing after another after another. We had to get privileged communication protection. We didn't have it. Psychologists and psychiatrists had privileged communication protection. You could take a marriage and family therapist, a counselor, a social worker, put them on the stand, ask them what was said in the therapy session, and they had to testify. It wasn't. We had confidentiality in our code of ethics, but privileged communication, you know the difference between privileged communication and confidentiality? Privileged communication is a legal thing. It means who can be forced to testify in court or not. Confidentiality is kind of an ethical thing. Okay. So it took us several years to get privileged communication protection. There were attacks on our licensing law. A guy named Walter Ray, who was the president of the Senate, guess what he did before he was president of the Senate? This is Georgia. His occupation, Elvis interpreter. In person.
Oh my God.
If you go to his office, it's not there anymore, there was a big wooden cutout of Elvis in his office, and when you push the button, the hips would swivel.
Oh,
he was the president of the Senate. His wife wanted to get, was in the Valdosta State program with John Curtis before it became a marriage and family therapy program, and it was still a sociology program. And she wanted to get licensed as a marriage and family therapist. He put a bill in the legislature to cut the licensing requirements for marriage and family therapists from 3 years in a practicum to 9 months. And guess what? He was the president of the Senate. We testified in the Senate that the marriage and family therapists in Georgia were opposed to this, and he testified that the marriage and family therapists in Georgia supported it. And he was the president, and they believed it. And it passed the legislature. So we went to the governor, because he could veto it. We said to the governor, veto this. And the governor needs the president of the Senate to get his budget to the Senate, so the governor wouldn't veto it. So now we lost in the legislative branch, we lost in the executive branch. We're in the middle of trying to convince insurance companies to reimburse marriage and family therapists and counselors and social workers, and suddenly they have 4 years experience and we have 9 months. It's like hard to make the case that we're just as good, right? So what we did is we went to court. We hired the best attorney in Atlanta, the guy who literally wrote the book. He wrote a book called Mental Health Law in Georgia. We hired him. We got an injunction, and we got the law stopped from going into effect. And we went back and negotiated with Walter Ray. And to this day, that's why the marriage and family therapy requirements for licensure are 2 years in a practicum, and counselors and social workers are 3 years in a practicum. It's still 1 year less for marriage and family, because of that whole thing that happened. What marriage and family therapists did to compensate for it is ours, years require more hours. So it's really the same line of experience, just more hours. That's how we convinced them that we were prepared. All kinds of other stuff over the years. The most recent, we added diagnosis. I'm just skipping over all the rest of what I said about all the history of our legislature in Georgia. And now, the most recent thing we did in marriage and family therapy is we added diagnosis to our scope of practices. Social workers had a diagnosis to theirs 2 years before us. We did it in 2014. You did it in 2012, I think. Counselors are in the middle of it right now in the legislature. If we didn't have to end now, I'd tell you what was going on with that. That's a story. Once you get a law like this, you can't just rest on your laurels. There's going to be one thing after another. There's going to be attacks on the law. There's going to be things you have to deal with. And right now, marriage and family therapists are trying to get 1013 authority. You know what 1013 authority is, right? Social workers have had it since the early 90s. Counselors got it. Well, they still have a bill that said that theirs is sunset in 2017. They have it until 2017. We're trying to get it now. It's not going to happen. Crossover day was yesterday. You don't even know what crossover day is. If it doesn't pass one house of the legislature by crossover day, it's dead for the session. And crossover day was Monday. We didn't pass the house, so we'll have to go back next year for our energy. So there's an ongoing process of working in the legislature regarding all of these bills. And the way you can protect your license, the way you can make sure that your license is not attacked, and that you get this, guess what it is? Tell me, what's the word?
Advocate.
What?
Advocate.
That's second. The first, join your professional association. You know who does this? You know who hires a lobbyist? You know, it's me, the legislative chair for the Georgia Association for Marriage and Family. I don't hire the lobbyists, but I'm down there as representative of GMFT, and we have the money to hire the lobbyists because people join the association and they pay their dues. You know, if you're going to be a marriage and family therapist or a counselor or a social worker in this state, you're not a freeloader. You join the association, you participate, you advocate, you put in your dues.